Let us worship God. Let's seek God's face together by lifting up our hearts in the singing of his praise. We'll sing from Psalm 29, and the tune is Psalm 29, verses 1 to 5. The tune is Milton, which is tune number 87. So if you have a red Psalter, the one that's split leaf with the tunes at the top, you'll find the tune on page 87, Psalm 29. Verses 1 to 5. Give ye unto the Lord, ye sons that of the mighty be, all strength and glory to the Lord, with cheerfulness give ye. Verses 1 to 5. Stand together for prayer. Our gracious and eternal God, we do come acknowledging that you are the invincible and almighty God, that you are limitless in your power, and your voice exudes that power, both in bringing forth the creation of this universe by the word of your power, in the space of 6 days, as well as in your word, which continues to bring your voice to your people. Your word is the power of God unto salvation, and your word is sharper than a two-edged sword. We come, O Lord, asking that you would give us ears to hear your voice in the scriptures, that your spirit would accompany them, that as we lift up our hearts in the singing of your praise, that these inspired songs would be woven into our affections and into our recollection, into our understanding. Grant that your word would be hid in our hearts, that we might not sin against you. And we ask, O Lord, that you would help us, that we would be given reverence and godly fear as we serve you in the public assembly of your people, as we offer before you our prayers and praise, as we bow down to receive your word as it is read and preached. Grant that we would come with sincere faith. Grant that we would know much of the joy of the Holy Ghost. Grant that we would sing with understanding and worship you in the true fear of the Lord. We come, O Lord, acknowledging that we cherish the Lord Jesus Christ, the great Lord of glory, who condescended to be made a sacrifice for sin. We thank you for his redeeming love and for his shed blood, which sprinkles and cleanses us from all of our sin. We thank you as well for the giving of the gift of the Holy Spirit, that Spirit of promise, sent forth in great effusions at Pentecost, and which continues to be given to each of your people in measure. We ask, O Lord, that you would hear our cries as we confess our sins to you. We acknowledge that we are a wayward people, that left to ourselves we would destroy ourselves, that left without your restraining grace we would forsake entirely the fountain of living waters. We would go after those hewn cisterns which are broken and can hold no water. We would bow down before rocks and stones and worship the creation of our own hands. But we rejoice, O Lord, that we have not been left to ourselves, that you have sent forth the light of your truth, and you have given to us the presence and power of your Spirit who accompanies the gospel. And so we come confessing that while, O Lord, we are a wayward people, that we are able nevertheless to unburden our hearts in repentance in the full assurance that because of Christ and his redeeming work that we can be found acceptable before you, that our sins can be cast, as it were, behind your back, buried in the sea, remembered no more, that we would be given an audience with the King, that we would be enabled to come boldly before your throne of grace in time of need. We rejoice, O Lord, in these tender mercies which are ours in Christ. We pray for your blessing upon our congregation. Bless us in this worship service. We ask, O Lord, that you would look with pity upon the unconverted. We pray that they, young and old alike, would be drawn to Christ in salvation. We pray that you would build your people. O Lord, grant that we would add line upon line, precept upon precept, that we would grow in wisdom, that we would grow in our acquaintance with your glory, that we would grow in obedience to your law out of hearts of love and gratitude, that we would grow in our love to one another, that the love of the brethren would abound, that we would love one another fervently out of a pure heart. We pray that you would make us a fruitful vineyard, that you would, by your Spirit, prune us, that you would produce, by your grace, fruit to the glory of your own great name. Help us, O Lord, to bring you great glory and great praise in our lives and in our walk before you. We pray for your blessing upon your kingdom. We pray for the churches in Northern Ireland this afternoon. We thank you for the faithful witness which is born, the gospel that is still preached in that country. And we ask, O Lord, that you would richly bless the churches there, bless our own brother and minister, fellow servant who labors in that country, encourage him, bless the church planning work that is being undertaken, and may that be given every blessing from heaven. You would establish more congregations in that place. We ask that you would revive your cause there, that you would bring reformation and revival to the churches of that land, and that you would push back the tide of the influences of Romanism and secularism, that you, Lord, would cause rather the truth to be flourishing, and that you would make the country spiritually green with the outpouring of your Spirit. Lord, we ask that you would encourage and strengthen your sheep in this place, that you would comfort those who mourn, that you would sustain and strengthen the weak, that you would impart wisdom to those who are struggling and uncertain about decisions that must be made. We ask that you would be pleased to furnish your people with increased assurance, that you would complete the good work that you've begun in us. And we pray as well, not only for ourselves, other faithful churches in this city and area. We thank you, O Lord, for them and pray that you would bless those who go forth preaching Christ sincerely, that as your word is proclaimed, that you would use it powerfully in the souls of those who hear it, and that there would be a great harvest, bringing many souls into your barns. Help us now, O Lord, as we continue to worship you in spirit and in truth. Grant us a sense of your presence. Encourage and strengthen us in each portion of the worship. And we ask that Christ Jesus himself would have all the preeminence among us. We ask it in his precious name. Amen. Let's continue to worship the Lord by singing together from Psalm 63. This is the second and third singing are our sequential singings, where we sing through the Psalms over and over and over. So we're working our way back through again, and we come where we left off this morning at Psalm 63. We'll sing the first half, verses 1 to 5, to the tune Paisley, which is tune number 97. Psalm 63, we referred to in the sermon this morning. You'll remember David is in the southern Judean wilderness. He's been chased away by Absalom. And here he is giving vent to his heart's desire. He's longing for the Lord. There's this spiritual thirst to behold the Lord, to see the Lord, to have the Lord. One thing that hadn't struck me as much as it has this week in preparing for this afternoon service, notice the reference to sanctified memory in verse 2, that I thy power may behold in brightness of thy face, as I have seen thee heretofore within thy holy place. And now he's in the wilderness apart from Jerusalem, and he's saying, Lord, I'm desiring to see your glory as you've shown me that glory in times past in the sanctuary. Well, let's lift up our hearts then to the Lord and sing verses 1 to 5.
Flesh long dead, the dry heart.
Our first scripture reading, our Old Testament reading, is found in the book of Deuteronomy. So if you'll take your Bibles and turn with me to Deuteronomy chapter 6. Deuteronomy chapter 6. Beginning at verse 1. Now these are the commandments, the statutes, and the judgments which the Lord your God commanded to teach you, that ye might do them in the land whither ye go to possess it, that thou mightest fear the Lord thy God to keep all his statutes and his commandments, which I command thee, thou and thy son's son, all the days of thy life, and that thy days may be prolonged. Hear therefore, O Israel, and observe to do it, that it may be well with thee, and that ye may increase mightily, as the Lord God of thy fathers hath promised thee, in the land that floweth with milk and honey. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thine heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy might. And these words which I command thee this day shall be in thine heart, and thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children, shalt talk of them when thou sittest in thine house, when thou walkest by the way, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up. And thou shalt bind them for a sign upon thine hand, and they shall be as frontlets between thine eyes. And thou shalt write them upon the posts of thy house and on thy gates, and it shall be, when the Lord thy God shall have brought thee into the land which he sware unto thy fathers, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob, to give thee great and goodly cities which thou buildest not, and houses full of all good things which thou fillest not, and wells digged which thou diggest not, vineyards and olive trees which thou plantest not, when thou shalt have eaten and be full. Then beware, lest thou forget the Lord, which brought thee forth out of the land of Egypt from the house of bondage. Thou shalt fear the Lord thy God and serve him, and shalt swear by his name. Ye shall not go after other gods of the gods of the people which were round about you. For the Lord thy God is a jealous God among you, lest the anger of the Lord thy God be kindled against thee and destroy thee from off the face of the earth. Ye shall not tempt the Lord your God, as ye tempted him in Massah. Ye shall diligently keep the commandments of the Lord your God, and his testimonies, and his statutes which he hath commanded thee. And thou shalt do that which is right and good in the sight of the Lord, that it may be well with thee, and that thou mayest go in and possess the good land which the Lord sware unto thy fathers, to cast out all thine enemies from before thee, as the Lord hath spoken. When thy son asketh thee in time to come, saying, What mean the testimonies and the statutes and the judgments which the Lord our God hath commanded you? Then thou shalt say unto thy son, We were Pharaoh's bondmen in Egypt, and the Lord brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand. And the Lord showed signs and wonders, great and sore, upon Egypt, upon Pharaoh, and upon all his household before our eyes. And he brought us out from thence, that he might bring us in, to give us the land which he sware unto our fathers. And the Lord commanded us to do all these statutes, to fear the Lord our God for our good always, that he might preserve us alive as it is at this day. And it shall be our righteousness, if we observe to do all these commandments before the Lord our God, as he hath commanded us. Amen. May God bless the reading of this portion of his inspired word. Let's continue to worship the Lord, lifting up our hearts and voices to him. Turn back to Psalm 63, and we'll sing the remainder of this psalm, Psalm 63, beginning at verse 6 through verse 11, and the tune is Weatherby, which is tune number 145. We left off with those words in verse 5, "Then shall my mouth with joyful lips sing praises unto thee, when I do thee upon my bed remember with delight, and when on thee I meditate in watches of the night." This is describing the Christian who is calling to mind, remembering with delight the things of God and meditating upon his word. Let's sing verses 6 to 11. Worship God again in the reading of his word. Our second reading is found in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And it's from this passage that we'll be taking our text this afternoon. We'll read together 1 Corinthians chapter 15, beginning at verse 1. Let's give careful attention to the reading of God's holy word. "Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also ye have received, and wherein ye stand, by which also ye are saved, if ye keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless ye have believed in vain. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures, and that he was seen of Cephas, then of the 12. After that he was seen of above 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain unto this present, but some are fallen asleep. After that he was seen of James, then of all the apostles. And last of all he was seen of me also, as of one born out of due time. For I am the least of the apostles, that am not meet to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, And his grace, which was bestowed upon me, was not in vain, but I labored more abundantly than they all, yet not I, but the grace of God which was with me. Therefore, whether it were I or they, so we preach, and so ye believed. Now if Christ be preached that he rose from the dead, how say some among you that there is no resurrection of the dead? And if there be no resurrection of the dead, then is Christ not risen? And if Christ be not risen, then is our preaching vain, and your faith is also vain. Yea, and we are found false witnesses of God, because we have testified of God that he raised up Christ, whom he raised not up, if so be that the dead rise not. For if the dead rise not, then is not Christ raised, and if Christ be not raised, your faith is vain. Ye are yet in your sins. Then they also which are fallen asleep in Christ are perished. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men most miserable. But now is Christ risen from the dead and become the firstfruits of them that slept. For since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. But every man in his own order, Christ the firstfruits, afterward, they that are Christ's at his coming. Then cometh the end, when he shall have delivered up the kingdom to God, even the Father, when he shall have put down all rule and all authority and power, for he must reign till he hath put all enemies under his feet. The last enemy that shall be destroyed is death, for he hath put all things under his feet. But when he saith all things are put under him, it is manifest that he is accepted, which did put all things under him. And when all things shall be subdued unto him, then shall the Son also himself be subject unto him that put all things under him, that God may be all in all. Else what shall they do which are baptized for the dead, if the dead rise not at all? Why are they then baptized for the dead? And why stand we in jeopardy every hour? I protest by your rejoicing which I have in Christ Jesus our Lord, I die daily. If after the manner of men I have fought with beasts at Ephesus, what advantageth it me, if the dead rise not? Let us eat and drink, for tomorrow we die. Be not deceived. Evil communications corrupt good manners. Awake to righteousness and sin not, for some have not the knowledge of God. I speak this to your shame. But some man will say, how are the dead raised up, and with what body do they come? Thou fool, that which thou sowest is not quickened except it die, and that which thou sowest not that body that shall be, but bare grain. It may chance of wheat or of some other grain. But God giveth it a body as it hath pleased him, and to every seed his own body. All flesh is not the same flesh, but there is one kind of flesh of men, another flesh of beasts, another of fishes, and another of birds. There are also celestial bodies and bodies terrestrial. But the glory of the celestial is one, and the glory of the terrestrial is another. There is one glory of the sun, and another glory of the moon, and another glory of the stars. For one star differeth from another star in glory. So also is the resurrection of the dead. It is sown in corruption. It is raised in incorruption. It is sown in dishonor. It is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness. It is raised in power. It is sown a natural body. It is raised a spiritual body. There is a natural body and there is a spiritual body. And so it is written, the first man, Adam, was made a living soul. The last Adam was made a quickening spirit. Howbeit, that was not first which is spiritual, but that which is natural, and afterward that which is spiritual. The first man is of the earth, earthy. The second man is the Lord from heaven. As is the earthy, such are they also that are earthy. And as is the heavenly, such are they also that are heavenly. And as we have borne the image of the earthy, we shall also bear the image of the heavenly. Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, neither doth corruption inherit incorruption. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Amen. Our text this afternoon is found in this portion that we've just read together from 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And I would direct your attention to verse 2. Our text is 1 Corinthians 15, verse 2. We've been celebrating the Lord's Supper, and just as we took a break from our exposition of John this morning in order to give our attention to the theme of Christ crucified and his atonement, so likewise this afternoon we take a break from our exposition of 1 Kings to think and reflect about our response to the Lord's Supper, our response of love and gratitude, which is manifest in many ways toward him. So let me direct your attention to 1 Corinthians 15, verse 2. By which also ye are saved. So going back to verse 1. Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel, which I preached unto you, which also ye have received, and wherein ye stand. By which also ye are saved, if ye keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless ye have believed in vain. If you had a grandparent who left you an heirloom, you would prize it. You would value it. Perhaps because of your love for the grandparent, perhaps because it had been passed down for a few generations, perhaps because of the value of the item itself. But you would not sell it at a yard sale, and you would not put it in a place where it could be lost or thrown out. You would value it as something that is important. Well, here is the Apostle Paul writing to the church at Corinth. And he is preparing in chapter 15 to declare and defend the resurrection as part of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. And he adds these opening words at the beginning of the chapter in verses really 1 to 4 or 5 or 6 thereabouts. He gives us these introductory words, and they include what we're considering here in verse 2. He says, you have the gospel that's been preached to you, and this is your salvation, if you keep it in your memory, and if you have not believed in vain. So in other words, he's saying, you have had placed into your trust this invaluable thing that God has given to you. He's given to you the gospel, all of its glory. And now you are to prize it. You're to preserve it. You're to protect it, to keep it. and to do so by keeping it in your memory, by keeping in your memory the things that the Lord has shown to you. And I think this is helpful at a number of points for us as we think about our response to the sacrament of the Lord's Supper. What happens? We have the Lord coming to us, giving us the gospel. We hear it in the preaching of his word, the preaching of Christ crucified. We see it not only in the written word, but we also see it in the visible word, in the signs and seals of the covenant within the Lord's Supper as well. These things are to be kept in our memory. In other words, when we finish the Lord's Supper and we go away from the table, it is not all over for us. There is a perpetual, a sustained, an ongoing interaction and experience with all that we have heard and learned and received from the Lord. And this is marked out in the nature of the supper itself. Jesus says, when he gives us the Lord's Supper, that we're to do this in remembrance of me, he says. Do it in remembrance of me. There's a direct tie here to the importance of keeping memory fresh, maintaining and holding these things in our hearts and in our minds. So we'll give ourselves and our attention this afternoon to that theme, this theme of sanctified memory from verse 2. If ye keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless ye have believed in vain. So three things that I draw to your attention. First of all, the value that we should place on the memory of spiritual things. We're to value the memory of spiritual things. Memory is what? Memory is part of our understanding. So it's a part of that faculty of our soul, our understanding, our minds. And of course, it works in cooperation with our brains as well. And so the Lord has given to us a faculty, though, that enables us to retain things. So you think of wax that's warmed, and then you can come and press a seal into the wax and lift it off. And the wax receives the seal. It's shaped and molded by the seal and continues to show the seal, as it were. And our memory is like this. The Lord comes and stamps things upon our minds, which we are to keep up and retain, an impression that we receive from him. We can also think of memory as a treasure trove. As we're going through our earthly pilgrimage, the Lord is showering things upon us. The reading of his word, the preaching of the word that we sit under, the exposition of scripture, books that we're reading that break open and explain and apply the word. All of these treasures are coming to us. God's word itself is better than gold and silver and precious stones, sweeter than honey to us. And as we continue to walk with the Lord, we're taking these treasures. And many of them we're storing in a treasure house of our memory. We're keeping them, as it were, to be able to pull them out, to recall them, to think about them, to enjoy them in the future. Memory is like a little kingdom, if you will. And you can take a person and put them in an empty room, shut and lock the door. Some people may go mad. Others of us might be delighted, right? You have the opportunity to think, and you can draw on the resources that God has given to you in your mind. So memory is something that enables us to retain what we've heard, what we've read, what we've learned, and to then be able to recall it in order to bring it back. And so isn't that interesting? Something that is past, we can't do time travel. No one's going back, you know, a decade or two to be there where you once were, right? The past is past. It's gone. And yet we have this remarkable ability because of the way that God has created us and designed us to take what is past and to bring it, as it were, back into the present through our memory, through our minds. We're able to bring these things, summon them back back to us. And you think of the various ways that this comes out in Scripture. In Luke 16, Abraham is in heaven and he's speaking to the rich man in hell. And he says, remember the good things that you had in your life, right? Or I think of the Jews in the Old Testament, just on the heels of exile. And the Zerubbabel is rebuilding this temple and so on. And the temple's complete. And there are the old folk, right? The old folk who've survived all of those years. And they come, and there's the mix of joy and sadness. Some are shouting with joy and happiness. Others are weeping. Some are happy. The temple's been restored. Others were sad. Why? Because these old, venerable saints looked upon the temple and remembered in their minds the glory of the previous temple, the glory of Solomon's temple before the Babylonians had come and decimated and destroyed and hauled off all of its glory and so on, reduced it to rubble. They could remember the glory of the previous temple, and they wept because in comparison, what had replaced it was nothing in contrast, right? We remember images. We remember words. We remember books. We remember sermons and so on. These things are laid up in the storehouse of our minds for the future. You know, there are, for all of us, instances where the Lord deals with us. I mean, there are certain sermons we will never, ever forget. And even in seasons of our life, they may not have been turning points for us, but there are sermons that stand out that we keep with us, right? When I was a seminary student, worshiping at a church here in Greenville, I still recall a handful of sermons that I can tell you about to this day. I can tell you the text, and I can tell you much of the substance of what was said. These are things that the Lord gives to us. Communion seasons are especially this way, right? Because we're engaged in remembering the Lord, and we are having this fellowship and intimate communion with him and so on. There are impressions that are brought down from heaven, the Lord dealing with us, striving with our souls. And we often then have much to take away that we keep and remember, so that it's not as if we sit down to feed upon Christ by faith at the table and then all's done, but rather we continue to feed on the resources that we've received in the preaching, at the table itself. These continue to nourish us days and weeks, perhaps in some cases years into the future. All of this would be lost without memory. Everything that we experience would only be in that moment. But God's goodness is preserved through the memory of God's people. I've told you this, some of you, this story before. There's an account of a man who sat under the preaching of John Flavel, one of the English Puritans, eminent, godly, faithful man. He was an adolescent at the time, an Englishman. He listened to Flavel preach, and it was just shortly after that he got on a boat and went off to America, arrived in America. He was 15 years old when he came to America. He lived an ungodly life. He did not walk with the Lord. He did not receive the gospel. He did not seek to glorify God and so on. He lived into his old age here in these United States. And it was well up into his old age, nearing 100, we're told, that the Spirit of God brought back to his memory the sermon that he had heard preached by John Flavel, who had been dead for decades. And it was under the influence of that sermon that he ended up being converted in his old age. These things had been stored up to his everlasting good later on. The Lord, the Holy Spirit, takes the Word of God that he puts in our hearts and minds, and the Spirit accompanies that Word and can bring it back to our minds in order to apply comfort, in order to apply conviction, and so on. And so this is why it's so important we value the memory of spiritual things. We're to be actively, intentionally storing these things up in our hearts, right? It's possible to wake up in the morning and for a psalm to come to mind. Why? Because you have memorized these metrical psalms, and they're in there. And so you can wake up and you can have psalms come to mind that greet you as you were for your first breath, your first meal of the day, as you reflect and think upon these things. Children, this is why for you, children, it is so essential that in your youth you be storing up as much as possible of God's Word. What's happening is you are working in advance. You're starting in your youth. You're memorizing Scripture. You're memorizing the Catechism inside and out. You're memorizing the metrical psalms. You're sitting under sermons. You're observing communion seasons, all these sorts of things. You're to take and absolutely slam-pack your mind with the truth. The more that you have laid up in your heart and mind, and the earlier that you have laid it up, the longer you're able to profit from it. Right? So the Lord himself says so. This isn't just Pastor McCurley. God says in Ecclesiastes 11, children, remember him. Remember your Creator in the days of your youth. How shall a young man keep himself pure? Young men, taking heed according to God's word, right? We hide God's word in our hearts that we might not sin against him. That's not just having God's word on the page. It's having it in our hearts and in our minds. This is a means by which we grow in the knowledge of God. It's a means by which we grow in faith and comfort and thankfulness and hope and repentance and usefulness and a whole host of other things. We're to value the memory of spiritual things. Secondly, we're to sanctify the memory of spiritual things. Here is Paul, and he's saying, listen, you have heard, you have received, you are standing in this gospel which saves you. Keep it in your memory. So there's a lot that's happened. He says, you've heard it, you've received it, you're standing in it, you're saved by it. But you need to continue to sanctify your memory. You need to have those things lodged in your memory, lest your believing be in vain. There is a sin that we often overlook, the sin of forgetfulness, right? I call it spiritual amnesia. God's people are plagued with spiritual amnesia. Most people like to think of forgetfulness as incidental. So what happens? We say to a child, you know, make sure you pick up your room before you go outside. An hour later, we come in and the room's not picked up and they're outside. We say, what did Mama say? What did Daddy say to you? And they say, Oh, I forgot. And see, the idea is this is an excuse. I didn't intentionally, you know, disobey. I just forgot. And we, if we are being consistent and on our better days, we explain to them, you are responsible to remember. Forgetfulness isn't an excuse. It's part of obedience. And you are responsible to remember the things that you've been told and to do them. So it is a form of disobedience, right? It is disciplinable. And yet we do the same thing with ourselves. We'll say, oh, well, I forgot. You know, it was a mistake. It was unintentional. Do you know that when you go back to the Old Testament, I've said this before, one of the number one sins, one of the most frequently mentioned sins in the Old Testament is spiritual forgetfulness. Yes, idolatry is at the top of the list, but forgetfulness is second, if not close. The Lord is constantly telling his people to remember, and he's constantly rebuking them for their forgetfulness. Over and over and over. You have forgotten me days without number. Mother doesn't forget her babe. You have forgotten me. You have forgotten me. Over and over we see the Lord rebuking his people. And so we need to be sanctifying our memory of spiritual things. Now, it includes remembering sometimes our own sins in order to humble us, right? We tend to, there's a sense in which we remember sinful things wrongly. So we'll remember the sinful things and we'll forget the spiritual or good things, right? This is wrong. We're keeping in our memory those sinful things that have happened and we're losing the good things that God has given to us. And that ought not to be. But there is a sense in which we are to remember that we are sinful, right? We are to be humbled by the Lord in the recollection of our sinning against Him. But we are to be quick, we are to be diligent in forgetting, by and large, what is unprofitable. So there are things we've seen, things we've heard, things that we have memories of that were not profitable. These we are to engage in studied forgetfulness of, right? We're to be putting them out of our minds over and over in order to weaken the memory of them. You know, what do you do with the trash at home? You put it in the trash can. And what do you do with the stuff in the trash can? You take the bag, you haul it away, and take it to the dump or to the curb or whatever. You throw it out. This is true for the Christian. You know, we are to be forgetting, we're to be taking the trash out. We are to be interested and diligent in throwing away that which is unprofitable, that which is hurtful to us. So the temptation to bitterness, the temptation to nurse bitter thoughts, or the temptation toward recalling sinful, immoral images, or, you know, angry thoughts that we've had toward people in the past, or, you know, it could be just the foolishness that we've filled our lives with, idleness and, you know, idle jingles and other things that we've, stories that we've stored up in our minds. Rather, we're to be remembering what is profitable. We're to be remembering what will be spiritually edifying to us. In Jeremiah chapter 2, in verse 32, "Can a maid forget her ornaments or a bride her attire? Yet my people have forgotten me days without number." Or you think of what we sing in Psalm 77, in verse 11, which says, "I will remember the works of the Lord. Surely I will remember thy wonders of old." We are to be remembering what is profitable. We're to be heeding the exhortation to not forget the Lord. Now, the Lord's Supper is done in remembrance of Him. Interestingly, another ordinance, the Sabbath, is given to the work of remembrance. Remember the Sabbath to keep it holy. 6 days thou shalt labor, right? We're to be engaged in holy recollection, meditation, focusing our attention, storing up our minds with truth, bringing back to our hearts and attention the things that God has given to us in the past and savoring them. We're to be remembering what is profitable. Peter, speaking in both 1 and 2 Peter, he tells us in a few different places, "I am bringing this to your remembrance. I must cause you to remember this or that or the other thing." In 2 Peter chapter 1, for example, in verse 12, "Wherefore I will not be negligent to put you always in remembrance of these things, though you know them, and be established in the present truth." He goes on to say the same a little bit later. So we're to be remembering the truth, remembering God's word. We're also to be remembering our duties. So our memory, sanctified memory, keeps before us our priorities. What is it that the Lord would have us to do in order to glorify Him? Well, we should be remembering these things. In Hebrews chapter 13, we see some examples. It says in verse 2, "Be not forgetful. Be not forgetful to entertain strangers." In verse 3, "Remember them that are in bonds as bound with them." Right? These are calls to remember. Again, same chapter, and verse 16, "But to do good and to communicate, forget not. For with such sacrifices God is well pleased." Each of these are a call to remember the duties that God has laid upon us. We're to remember our vows. The vows that we make before God could be vows in our office. It could be in marriage, baptism. It could be just the personal vows that we make in our covenant relationship with the Lord, in connection with our communion with Him at home, you know, secret vows that we lay up before the Lord, or in connection with renewing our covenant at the Lord's table, and so on. We're to remember these things. We're to remember the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. This is something that's to be near and dear to the very our heartthrob. Psalm 137, the psalmist says, as you well know, "If I forget thee, O Jerusalem, let my right hand forget her cunning. If I do not remember thee, let my tongue cleave to the roof of my mouth. If I prefer not Jerusalem above my chief joy." He's saying, I need to remember the good and the cause of Zion. It is near and dear to our hearts because it is near and dear to the heart of the Lord Himself. Here the Lord is saying, we're to sanctify our memories. They're to be exercised. They're to be worked, as it will. And as I said earlier, there are times in which we need to remember our sins to keep us humble. Deuteronomy 9, verse 7, "Remember and forget not how thou provokest the Lord thy God to wrath in the wilderness." Remember the ways in which you've sinned against Him in order that you might walk humbly with Him and before Him. And so here, sanctifying our memory means filling it with good things. Well, we're all limited, right? We're not infinite. We don't have the mind of God. We have created minds, and they're come in diverse, with diverse capabilities. And there are all sorts of limitations. That should be obvious. If we desire to fill our memory with good things, then we're going to have to make decisions not to fill our memory with other things. So it's a crass analogy, but you can think in terms of a filing cabinet or a hard drive. There's only so much space to put things in. It's not limitless. And therefore, you have to choose what's going in and what's not. Not everything we can possibly want can fit. It's the same for us. Are we going to lay up, devote the space, as it were, to our spiritual, mental memory, to the best things, to the things that will most edify, the things that will most glorify the Lord? Another way I think of sanctifying our memory is by practice, not only hearing God's word, but doing it. Actually, self-consciously obeying the word of God cements it more deeply into our memories. But we're not to allow it to be crowded out with carnality and with the cares of this world and with sometimes idle curiosity and other things. Thirdly, we're to employ our memory of good things. Thirdly, we're to employ our memory of good things. "If ye keep in memory what I preached unto you." We're to employ our memory. It's very interesting. Those of you who have studied history will know this. Perhaps others who have studied disciplines like rhetoric will know this as well. In ancient times, they put a very high premium on memory. So I'm talking Greco-Roman era, especially. Very high premium. They prized the power of memory, and they devoted a great deal of time and attention to its study, how to maximize memory. And they would actually teach elaborate discourses on how to employ their memories. And they would look for ways to improve that. And so they had all sorts of, you know, great, wonderful feats. They could give long-winded, eloquent, beautifully delivered speeches, no aid given to them. And they had all sorts of tools that they had put in place, mnemonics and that sort of thing, to help them with memorizing long lists of names or other, you know, extraneous types of information and so on. It's very elaborate at times, elaborate tools to enable them to increase their memory. And these are pagans, right? They don't have the motivation that we have. We have eternal truth. We have something that is to be far more prized than they could ever have dreamed of. Should we not be even more motivated than they at employing our memory? It's interesting that our Reformed fathers put, you know, a good bit of attention on this as well, both the spiritual exercise and the kind of the practical side as well. You had, you know, the Renaissance and then the Reformation came, and there was exposure to some of those tools that had been used in the past and so on. So it would have been common in the days of, you know, the post-Reformation and even early American colonial Presbyterians and so on, people would nearly memorize, not word for word, but memorize the sermons. So they worked diligently at laying up in their hearts and minds the truths that they were hearing. And then when they went home, they would repeat the sermon. So that was actually the language that they used. They would go home, the father is the head of the house, in family worship, they would repeat the sermons. And so they would go back, and the children would be asked questions, and everyone would have their part in basically putting back together what they had heard in order to rehearse it, in order to more deeply ingrain it in their hearts and minds, to think through the applications and implications of what they had heard and so on. Well, this involves some practical decision making on our part, right? We have to work at it. We have to focus at it. We have to focus on it. We have to be deliberate, not just saying, "Well, I hope some things stick." You know, throw a bunch of things at our mind and hope maybe a few things will stick. No, there has to be a self-conscious intention. We're going to memorize Scripture, the Psalms. We're going to work hard at trying to digest the things that we're hearing or reading and to carry them with us as best as we can, as God gives us ability. Now, we recognize, of course, that there are the soul-body connection is very complex, and you know, there are things that affect the deterioration of the brain, and, you know, people aren't able to remember in their older years like they could in their earlier years, which reinforces my earlier point about the children really working hard to lay up in their minds as much truth as possible. So we're conscious of that, and we recognize that's physical, right? There's a physical element there. But whatever our capacity, we're to be employing that capacity for God's glory. And it may be that we need to give greater attention, you know, what we eat, and, you know, taking care of our physical bodies does have an effect on our brains and our ability to use them and so on. But we need to employ our memory in things that would be pleasing to the Lord. That can happen by repetition. So if you're trying to study for a history test or, you know, math, or you're learning a foreign language, what do you have to do? You have to review and review and review and review to get the dates down or to get your vocabulary down or whatever. There's repetition in order to make a deeper impression. This is why the sermons were repeated in the old days. That can be done by us. We can employ repetition going over the good things that God has provided for us. I'm thinking especially about the preaching of His Word and the sacrament of the Lord's Supper here this afternoon, but other things as well. These things can be retained. So Deuteronomy 11, verse 18, "Therefore shall ye lay up these my words in your heart and in your soul, bind them for a sign upon your hand, that they may be as frontlets between your eyes. You shall teach them your children, speaking of them when thou sittest in the house, when thou walkest by the way, when thou liest down, when thou risest up. Thou shalt write them upon the doorposts." And this is a form of repetition. It's saying you're to lay them up in your heart, but then you're to write them down, and you're to post them, and you're to have cues that remind you, that bring back to your thoughts the Word of God. You had the same thing with the kings. What did the kings do? One of their responsibilities was to take the law of God and to write out their own handwritten personal copy of the entire law for themselves and their personal reference. Deuteronomy 17 and verse 18, "And it shall be when he sitteth upon the throne of his kingdom that he shall write him a copy of this law in a book out of that which is before the priests, the Levites." Something that he could review, something he could refer to, something that he could go back to, reinforce the memory of God's law. Another thing that we can do in employing our memory is to pray over the things that God has given to us. We pray over the scriptures, we pray over the things that we've received from the Lord at the table and sermons and things that we're reading. When we incorporate these into our prayer, we're praying over the ground that God's given to us. And it too is enabling us to more deeply cling to these truths. Likewise with meditation, right? Meditation is kind of the blending of the Word and prayer, you know, brought together. And I've preached sermons on that in the past. But meditating on the things that God has provided for us, truths or scriptures, or another way of employing our memory. Now, it's of course true that, for example, in preaching, ministers have an obligation and responsibility in this as well, to do their best to make sermons as understandable and digestible and memorable as possible, right? So we have points to our sermons. Interestingly, in this sermon on memory, one of the rare occasions, there's no alliteration, you'll have noticed, in the 3 points. But often, you know, there are those sorts of tools that enable us to hold on to it better. For my own self, you know, remembering a sermon is aided by these sorts of things where you're able to recall the points, and once you recall the points, to recall some of the content that was under those. Sermons should be constructed in a way that will help the Lord's people remember them. And it's the same with parents teaching their children, right? In teaching the children, it's not just throwing all of this disconnected information at them, but we're to do it in ways that enable them to latch onto it, hooks to hang the information on, in order for them to be able to, in an orderly fashion, recall the things that they're being taught. And as I said, that means that we also need, in employing our memory, to put these things into practice, to put what we have learned into practice. In Psalm 103, we had sung this earlier, verse 18. "To such as keep his covenant, and to those that remember his commandments to do them." You have to know them, and you have to remember what you know in order to do what you remember that you know. Right? There's a connection here to our practice. Doing aids our memory aids our doing. I think the Psalms are helpful this way as well. Knowing the Psalms, familiarity with the Psalms. You perhaps have overlooked or not thought of recently, But there's actually one psalm that makes clear that this is part of the intention of the psalms. Psalm 38, the title is A Psalm of David to Bring to Remembrance. Psalm of David to Bring to Remembrance. Much of the psalms contain history. So the Lord put that into song so that it would work into the affections of God's people, into the hearts and minds of God's people. It would stay fresh. These songs, Zion's songs, the Lord's song that they're constantly going over and engaged in, would take the things that God had done with his people and keep them near and dear to their hearts. I think this is true of the Psalms as a whole, right? Martin Luther said the Psalms are a little Bible. They're a Bible in miniature. You know, Calvin said that they are the anatomy of the soul. So they give you all of the different parts of Christian experience. So everything's packed into one little place. And the Lord has given us this small, as it were, book of songs, which we not only read but sing, because in singing it, we remember it better. In singing it, it engages our affections as well as our minds. And in doing so, we have, as it were, a whole little Bible being laid up inside our souls that we're able to take with us, that we're able to sing in the car, you know, in the yard, wherever else that we find ourselves. And it's bringing back the word of the shepherd, the word of Christ himself into the forefront of our memories. We're to be employing our memory of these good things, the spiritual things that God has given to us. Paul is about to teach them about the doctrine of the resurrection as an indispensable component to the gospel. And he's saying, you have to keep these things that you've heard in your memory. Since the Lord's Supper is done in remembrance of him, it is important for us in our response to that supper to carry away the things the Lord's given us, to keep in memory the things that the Lord has brought to us, how he's spoken to us in the supper itself, that we would continue to eat and drink and feed upon the nourishment that he's provided. This is a means of expressing our gratitude. This is a means of expressing our love. This is a means of profiting rightly from the ordinance that the Lord has provided for us. So may the Lord enable us to keep in memory the gospel that comes to us both in the written word and in the visible word. Let's stand together for prayer. O Lord our God, we come and thank and praise you once again for all of the riches of grace that are found in Christ Jesus. We thank you that this gospel has been preached to us, that we have received it, that it is in that gospel that we stand and by which we are saved. And we pray, help us, O Lord, to keep in memory that which we have received. Enable us, O Lord, to cherish all that belongs to Christ, all of your word, all of your ways, all of your works. O Lord, grant that we would be a people who are filled more and more with the light and truth, the substance of the mind of God, that we would think your thoughts after you, and that your word would dwell in us richly. We ask in Jesus' name, amen. Let us respond to the reading and preaching of God's word by singing from Psalm 115, verses 12 to 18. This is the end of the psalm. The tune is Talus, which is tune number 138. Tune 138. Psalm 115, verses 12 to 18. We've been speaking about the importance of us remembering the Lord and his word. But here, the tables are turned. And we conclude this afternoon by speaking or singing about the fact that the Lord remembers us. Right? This is the gospel, and this is what we cherish. The Lord remembers us. The Lord of us hath mindful been, and he will bless us still. He will the house of Israel bless, bless Aaron's house, he will. Verses 12 to the end. Stand for the benediction. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.